I didn't start predator fishing until I was in my late teens, but coming from a fishing family, I did a lot of fishing before that. I mean, I caught my first tench when I was 5 years of age in the Birmingham-Worcester Canal. Then I used to go regularly with my dad on matches when I was a teenager, fishing. Sometimes I could join in the matches. I used to enjoy it, actually. And we did a lot of trout fishing, either worm fishing, or I actually had my first introduction to fly fishing as a teenager. But really, I got into predators when I was about 16, 17. And it just sort of happened with a chance encounter when we were fishing for roach in the local park and the pike started attacking the roach. So we thought, how are we going to catch them? And in those days, you know, you couldn't pick up angling times and get all the tips like you can today. So we were just float fishing great big lob worms for the pike. And we were making a ground bait of mud and chopped up worms, and it used to draw the pike in. And that's, I caught my first double figure pike on a lob worm under a float. So that really got me fascinated by pike, and unexpectedly, it's, you know, I didn't expect it to happen, but it snowballed from there. I think the reason I've been involved with pike fishing, well, I can raise two reasons actually. It's probably a well-known story, but if you read my first book, on the day I was born, I was born at my grandma's house and I was laid out on the kitchen table. And my father had actually been out pike fishing. He was pike fishing actually as I was being born. And my mother laid me out on the table and my aunties were all there admiring me. And knock on the door, my dad comes in. Typical of my dad, he said, "Oh, you've had the baby then. What did it weigh?" 7 pounds, 2 ounces. He said, "Wait a minute." Went to his motorbike and on the sidecar, he got a slightly bigger pike. About, he said, "I'll beat you today. I've had one about 8 pounds. And so I was actually laid out side by side with a pike when I was only two or 3 hours old. But as I say, I mentioned earlier that I was involved with a little bit of match fishing on the Birmingham match scene with my dad. And in those days, pike were despised. And if people caught them in the matches, they would just either kill them or throw them up the bank. And I used to go around behind the matchmen, getting these pike and putting them back in the river. Or I'd bring them home and keep them in aquariums and look after them. And I think I just built up this sort of bond and relationship. And I just felt I could see something in the pike that, you know, I thought that the ignorant people around me couldn't see at the time. And, you know, that bond has stayed with me to this very day. I can remember my first 20 pounder very well. It weighed 20 pounds, 8 ounces, and it came from the Hampshire Avon River. And it was 1972, January, and it was around the time that, that me and my mates, we got our first cars, and we were inspired by all the big name venues of the day, the Hampshire Avon, the Broads, the Fens. And rather than fish locally, we used to travel hundreds of miles to fish such places. And I remember on a January day, I had a run on a great big herring, and I had my first 20 from this big churning backswim of, and it weighed 20 pound 8 ounces. I've been a professional angler for about 20 years, but before that I was actually working in engineering. I actually served an apprenticeship in plastics engineering. And until I was in my early 30s, I was working in the plastics industry, which incidentally is a very good position to have come from when you're working in the fishing tackle trade, because as you well know, a lot of the stuff in fishing tackle trade is made from plastic. And I've got a great understanding of the processes that go into making all the fishing tackle that we use today. But up until I was in my early 30s, I worked in engineering. But I was always looking out of the window thinking, you know, I like the job I do, I'm good at it, but I'd rather be outside. And as a planning engineer, I actually planned my way out of industry and into fishing. And, you know, it wasn't something that happened overnight, but it was always in my mind that I could make a living from fishing. I didn't know how I was going to do it, but I was determined to do it. You know, when I look back, I realise that there probably wasn't one event that enabled me to become a professional angler. You can't really plan these things. You certainly couldn't 20 years ago. It was something that just evolved step by step. The first step, really, to get yourself noticed is to start writing articles for the weeklies and the monthlies. And I've been doing that for many years. But I didn't know where it would lead to. But it was around the time when videos were starting to come out. And people like Kevin Maddox and Len Gerd were starting up video production companies. And they approached me to make a couple of pike fishing videos. And then, say, that moved on. Crowwood Press said, well, will you write us a book? And all of a sudden, when you've exposed your personality and your ability, you know, to the wider public, you become valuable to the tackle trade. And my big break really came, if I'd got to say there was a break, it was probably when I bumped into Matt Hayes in the mid-90s. I was already earning a little bit of a living from fishing, but then I bumped into Matt. And it was at a pike fishing event at Ringstead Grange. Neither of us had got a boat partner, so we spent the day together. And Matt said, you know, how would you like to, you know, join me, do a little bit of filming, see where it leads. And that was when Matt's first Total Fishing series came out. And, you know, I felt quite honoured to be given the chance, really. Not realising that apart from just taking part in the Total Fishing series, there was a little bit of, if you like, I think the people who took part in that series were actually being vetted to see whether they could actually go any further. And luckily, Matt chose me, and he came to me and he said, do you fancy doing a complete series with me? So that led on to us doing wet nets. That made me more valuable than being exposed on television, made me more valuable to the trade. So then the deals started to come from Shimano and from Fox, and it's just got better and better. Up until the last few years, obviously, when the recession has knocked things back a bit, but I've managed to maintain that connection with the trade and the media and made quite a reasonable living for a total of 20 years and still going strong. I think the reason why I've been accepted on television is that I'm not fazed at all by it. I'm not self-conscious, or I'm not worried about how I appear. I just go on there, and I'm quite happy just to behave naturally. And whatever happens, happens. You know, warts and all. I don't mind, you know, having a laugh at myself and people having a laugh at my expense. You know, that's life. And I think the public like that sort of thing. You know, they warm to you as a human being, really. I've been very lucky to work with Matt, and to some extent I realise that, you know, Matt has helped carry me along, because let's face it, you know, Matt was out there, he was setting up the shows, and you know, which helped put me where I am today, and you know, I've got a lot to thank Matt for. But he's been the driving force, and I've always realised that. And Matt's a very ambitious, very capable person. And an absolute top-notch angler as well. And to be associated with him has helped me tremendously. But I think slowly I've had a chance then to become my own person. And Matt and I still do a lot together today. We still fish together. But yeah, I feel I've got a lot to thank Matt for. You know, when I look back at all the shows we've done, and Matt and I have done over 90 shows together, wet nets, the Great Rod Race, the Greater Rod Race, record-breaking fish, total fishing, it really is hard to pick one out, really. I think, if I'm honest, it's probably the one where we catch the smallest fish, and it's not about fishing. It's about, I think, the humour side of it. I hope it comes across, because We've had a great time making the films. And the ones I've enjoyed the most are where we've had the best laugh, to be honest, like catching the stickleback, using a matchstick for a float. And I enjoyed that. And at the other end of the scale, I really enjoyed the night when we caught a brace of 60-pound catfish. There was something magic about that night. You know, we didn't know whether we would achieve it, and it just happened like clockwork. There's just too many, you know. If I stopped to think about it, I could probably pull another one out, but it was all great fun. The most frustrating fish to catch probably was when we were doing record-breaking fish and we tried to catch a catfish. And again, you know, I don't mind laughing at myself. I'm supposed to be a bit of a catfish expert, but I just could not catch one. And in the end, Matt caught one. It wasn't a particularly big one, but, you know, Matt pulled something out of the bag. But the ironic thing is that just afterwards, I went catfishing on my own. And I caught a brace of 60 pounders one evening on my own. But, you know, it doesn't always happen on the day when you're filming. A lot of people call me the Duke now, or Sir Michael, and, you know, it's a bit of a tongue-in-cheek thing. And it all started, Matt started calling me these names, and the reason is quite simple. I am the exact opposite of a Duke, you know. You know, to put it crudely, I'm a rough-arsed Brummy angler, the other end of the scale, but when we're on the boat, we have a bit of a laugh, and Matt likes to build me up, and it's just stuck, and the public have enjoyed it. People love my camper van. Everywhere I go, they see the camper van first, you know, before they see me. And, that, you know, I even go down the motorway and I have people pull alongside, pipping and waving. And it wasn't planned, but the camper van has just, you know, become a personality as much as Matt and myself. It's 22 years old. I've had it for 12 years, and it's very, very reliable. But being an engineer by training, I make sure that mechanically it is 100% fit for purpose. The bodywork leaves a bit to be desired, but I've got it all kitted out. I've got my bed in there, my cooking gear, my television. It literally goes anywhere. Oh, it looks like I'm going to be joined by one of my dogs. You know, my life changed a lot when I moved from Birmingham to the Fens, which was back in 1987. And I'd always been aware of the fact that if I was going to be successful, I needed to catch more fish and become more experienced. And living in Birmingham, I didn't think I was going to get that sort of experience. It was all, you know, a matter of going fishing at weekends. And I needed the fishing to become more of, you know, more integrated with my way of life. And I spent a lot of time agonising over where I could move to. I wanted to move to the Broads. Oxfordshire was another choice. I wanted to be somewhere where fishing was, you know, something I could do every day instead of waiting till the weekend. And eventually a job came up at the Hot Point factory in Peterborough. And I jumped at the chance of taking it because it meant that I could live in the Fens. And here I am still today, and I located myself in the most perfect position for a predator angler. I mean, where I actually live, on the Lincolnshire-Cambridge border, within 5 miles radius of my house, there's over 100 gravel pits. There's three or four drains, there's the River Welland, and I could not begin to tell you the number of big pike and zander and eels and perch I've caught within that catchment. And of course, that's given me a massive advantage to becoming a full-time angler. You know, people often ask me what is the most memorable fish. And again, I struggle to pick one out because it's, to me, it's nothing about the size of the fish or where you caught it. The most memorable has got to be the one that I think that made you, you know, feel something really special. and it's not necessarily a big fish that I could relate to, you know. For example, I caught a 23-pounder a few weeks ago. It's not a big pike. I have caught hundreds of pike bigger than 23 pounds. But it was from a water I've been trying to crack for a few years. And I've literally spent whole winters on there trying to catch a 20-pound pike. And I finally caught a 23-pounder, and it was the most beautiful-looking fish. You can imagine the colours were just wonderful. And I can't tell you the sense of achievement and pride and satisfaction that gave me. Probably a lot more so than some of the 30-pounders I've caught. So it's not all about size. You know, I think anybody at any level in angling can feel that. I used to feel the same way on the local canal when I used to catch bream on the float when I was 17. You know, that feeling of just inner satisfaction, really. You know, I look back at all the television programmes I make, and there's one or two little regrets I have. And it is a fact that there's only so much time can be spent on editing these films. But sometimes some of the key points have been missed out. And there's two stories I wish had really been told. Now, the first one was that big carp I caught at the Monument, the 44-pounder. I mean, let's face it, I was very, very, very lucky to hook the biggest fish in the lake, but it did happen. But the way it happened was interesting, but it wasn't shown. And when you look at the film clip, I just have a run, and a conventional run, and the line's pouring off the bait runner, and a reel of fish in. But that isn't how it happened. What really happened was that we'd seen this big fish boshing out, and I said to Matt, I wonder whether I could reach it. We're running out of time and we haven't had a big fish. And I remember putting on a really tight PVA bag, checking the rod joints, and saying to the cameraman, if I cast as hard as I can, there's a chance the rod's going to break, but I'm going to take that chance. And I remember casting as hard as I could, and the rig's just about to land where we'd seen this carp, and the bag burst and spread all over the place. And I think it was Matt said, or the cameraman said to me, well, that's messed that up. And I said, well, no, it's in the vicinity. We haven't got much time. Let's leave it. And I sat back, and not long afterwards, I didn't get a run at all. Like a lot of carp anglers, I fish my rods at a slight angle. The line's coming out of the tip at a slight angle. The reason being that if you get a pickup that doesn't run off, you just see the tip pull round. And I could just see the tip just quivering. And it pulled round half an inch and stayed there. And I said, start filming, because that is a carp has got that in its mouth. And I picked up the rod, and sure enough, I felt this big lump on the end. A lot of people also don't know that a few nights before, I'd caught a 39 and a quarter pounder on another water when we weren't filming. So I knew I was hooked into something very similar. And of course, the rest is history. You know, I reeled in what was at the time the biggest carp ever filmed on television. If I could change one thing in fishing, you shouldn't have asked me that question, because I can think of lots of things I can change. But certainly with regard to predators, I think regardless of what is said in the media and in the press, I don't think anglers are handling pike anywhere and other predators anywhere near as good as they could be. They think they are, but my experience on the bank mixing with other pike anglers is that they make a pretty poor job of it. And that's not a criticism, it's just a fact that handling pike is not easy. I've been doing it all my life, and everyone I still have to handle with a lot of consideration and care, because every situation is different, seeing where the hooks are positioned, how you're going to remove them, and quite often it can be quite a surgical operation. And you can't expect people to do that easily and cleanly right from the start. And I think people should just take more time in rigging carefully, striking more quickly, and then generally handling the fish when they get on the bank in a better way. Have an unhooking mat ready, have the tools at hand. So often I see people just doing it, casually looking for the tools after they've got the fish on the net while it's in a tangle. Every stage needs to be thought through logically and with a view to getting the fish back in the water in the condition that you caught it. And I don't mean this as a criticism, but it's a fact that I think most pike anglers have still got a long way to go in that respect. You know, at the ripe old age of 66, I should have retired last year, and I always thought years ago that retirement meant, you know, you sat there with a pipe and you wore your slippers and watched the world go by. But it isn't like that really, because if you've got an inquiry in mind, if you're active, you want to be out there doing something, and I'm no different to anybody else. So I intend to carry on until I get to that stage where I literally have to go for the pipe and slippers and I can't get out. And I've got so many opportunities being offered to me at the moment. I've teamed up with Shimano Normark. They've got great plans for the future. You know, we've just been through a big period of change where the two companies have come together. We've sorted out all the staffing problems, and now the public will see that group of companies going forward, and I'm really pleased to be a big part of that. At the same time, I've taken on running the development of a large fishery in South Lincolnshire. We've got six lakes. We're setting it up for carp, big carp, pleasure fishing, pike fishing. And that gives me the great opportunity to use that as a centre for, going back to a previous question, for teaching anglers how to handle pike and how to fish for pike in a more responsible way. Add that to my publishing, my day-to-day writing work. You know, I've got enough to keep me going for years to come. You know, when I look back at a lifetime of fishing, I've seen a lot of changes, and I've seen fishing, especially predator fishing, come out of the dark ages. Pike, when I was young, were considered to be either vermin or food, but now, you know, through the work of the Pike Anglers Club and other bodies, they are seen as you know, as a top sporting fish. And of course, you know, a lot's grown with it. You know, the tackle industry has grown up with it. And I look back at, you know, all my travels abroad, and I've seen fishing in a different way. Scandinavia, Canada, Denmark. I've seen fish that I love to catch treated differently, you know, and in a lot of these countries they still are treated as food or vermin. This is slowly changing as well, because predators are across the world now being recognised as good sporting fish. But one thing that's worrying me now is that all that hard work we've done, which has actually seen the UK become one of the best pike fishing countries in the world, if you was to say to me, where's the best place to go pike fishing, I would say stay in the UK, it's brilliant. But things have changed in the last few years, and since we've had an influx of new anglers from abroad who don't share our values, you know, they've come from a country where they're the same as us 50 years ago. They saw pike as food, and now they're taking these fish, and it has set us back so much. I don't think they realise the damage they have done. Places I used to fish that I just don't bother anymore. I'm hearing horror stories all the time about fish being netted, long-lined. And not only has it affected the fishing, I think it's affected business and commerce. People are not going fishing to these places. Clubs are giving up waters. All the people who used to come to my area and spend money, bed and breakfasts on fuel in the shops and the pubs, they don't come here anymore because the fish are gone. And I've been the first to complain about, you know, the foreign anglers doing this, but I've realised to some extent it's not their fault. Some of them are out and out criminals, there's no doubt about it, but I think the majority haven't realised the trouble they've caused. And it's quite heartening to see that the Angling Trust are now working with bodies like the Polish Angling Association. These people are getting together and spreading the word amongst the immigrant community that we can't carry on like this. And although it's only a start, I'm starting to see this happening now, and I am actually myself working with the Angling Trust and the Polish community in a very small way, and I'm just hoping that, you know, this will spread across the country. It'll take a few years, but we've got to turn this situation round, and, you know, thanks to the Angling Trust, we can see some light at the end of the tunnel. So, you know, anybody who's got any feeling for their fishing and wants to see the great fishing we've had, you know, over the last decades, they want to see it carry on, they've got to put themselves, put their mouth where the money is, support the Angling Trust and support all these initiatives to put things right. I'll leave it at that because I could go on for hours discussing it, but I think this is the only way forward. You know, when I first cast a line, I had no idea I'd be sitting here today running a business out on the Lincolnshire Fens based upon fishing. Every penny that goes into my account comes from me going fishing. And I mean, that in itself has, you know, it's made my life worthwhile, because the last 20 or 30 years, every day has been about going out, catching fish, doing something interesting and feeling some sense of achievement. And I don't think I would have got that from staying in engineering. You know, I might have been, you know, a very successful engineer, probably with a lot more money in the bank today, but I wouldn't have felt that personal satisfaction. So fishing, it's just something that, you know, it's something you have to feel. What you get from fishing, you can't explain it to anyone. But there's thousands and thousands of people out there who feel the same way, I'm sure. And you don't have to be a professional angler to get that from it. You know, I think fishing brings something to everybody's life. And for that reason, you know, I think fishing should strongly be supported and encouraged. Up you come. There you go. Right. Come on, let's get you up. Come on, let's get you up. Right, that's it. Now, settle down. Settle down. You're on television now. Right? I'm answering the questions. You just be quiet now. If you want to add anything, do, but be quiet.
Okay, Mick. Predator angler from day one, start with other forms of fishing?
Right, well, first of all, that's the dog growling, not my stomach rumbling.
Okay, Mick, were you a predator angler from day one, or did you start with other forms of fishing?
Well, I actually started fishing just going up the local canal with my... Oh, f***ing sake. Shall I get these buggers out?
Yeah, go on then. Yeah.
Right.
Have you been a predator angler from day one, or did you start with other forms of fishing?
I didn't become a predator angler till... Oh, I'm going to have to put them right out the back now. I'm really sorry about
sure.
this.